Good evening, everyone. I want to welcome everyone to the regularly scheduled council meeting for March 20th, 2017 at 7 p.m. Before we get rolling, I know there's a lot of younger students in here tonight, so if you guys have cell phones, please put them on vibrate or turn them down for us. We'd appreciate it. And Mr. Collier, if you can go with the roll call, sir.
Mayor Lattery?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsey?
Here.
Mr. Lighty?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. Lethley?
Here.
Mr. Craybrook?
Here.
Seven members present.
Thank you, sir. You'll stand while tonight's invocation by Jeff Christmas.
Let us bow and pray. Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, once again, we gather here to do the business of our fair city. We thank you for our leadership. We are grateful, Lord, that you've placed authority in positions to help us in our times of need. And we especially think of our first responders, too, at any time that we gather, and we pray a blessing upon them. We pray now that you would be with every decision made and every opinion rendered, and we pray that all things would be done decently and in order, and we thank you for the blessings that we receive. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We'll do the pledge tonight. We'll use the flag in the back.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Here. Good? All right, we'll need actions on the regular scheduled council meeting of March 6, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
That's motion by Mr. Craybrooker?
Yes.
Correct.
Second by Mr. Lethley?
Yes, sir.
Any discussion, council, on the minutes?
Mr. Craybrooker?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Lighty?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Passes 7-0.
And moving on, we will need a motion to accept the minutes for the town hall meeting, March 6, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Lindsey, second by Mr. Craybrooker.
Any discussion, council? When you're ready.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Lighty?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mr. Craybrooker?
Yes.
Oh, I had thoroughly enjoyed that tonight. Yes. 4.5 hours worth.
Well, how long did it take you to do it?
4.5 hours, about 12 hours. Listen to it, go back.
Go back.
All right, before we move on to communications, which there isn't tonight, I just wanted to mention to council, after the last council meeting, and I know there was a lot of everyone was here and then some of us out here were here, I just wanted to stress that we try and make sure we keep a tight and orderly meeting. After the last meeting, I know that, you know, when things start getting said, ideas pop in your head, and people start talking over other people, so I want to make sure that we, you know, we don't speak until it's, you know, their turn to give them the floor and make sure that we run a nice, tight and orderly meeting. So. With that said, Mr. Craybrooker has a few words he would like to say, so I will give that to you, sir.
Similar to that, except for I'm on, you know, we voted on the rules of council, you know, in the beginning of the year. And so in the rules of council, I just want to make everybody aware is that, you know, we are allowed the audience 5 minutes, you know, not 15 minutes, not 10 minutes, 5 minutes. And also when you're speaking, according to the rules of council, you're speaking to council. You're not speaking to the administration. So, and if we need information, either the mayor, myself, or one of the council members will ask for that information. So I just want to make sure you're clear. In the past, I know we've gotten away from that, but Mike and I, you know, have done a lot of talking back and forth, and we think we need to go back to the rules of council.
Good. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. All right, moving on. Communications of the night, city manager's report. Mr. Bridge.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Mr. Members of the Council, members of the public. I'd like to share with you the city manager's report. We're going to jump on down to our finance discussion with our finance director, Ms. Colleen Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, Mayor, Council, and members of the public here tonight. The financial report is for the month of February. Total revenue that we received for February was $327,495.61. Total expenditures for the month of February is $251,652.42. We are still working on our temporary budget. Year-to-date expenditures are $601,605.51. Outstanding Outstanding encumbrances, $203,643.69, which brings the total year-to-date on our expenditures of $694,750.80. Year-to-date revenue, which is on the page three, is $513,780.82. Still collecting, putting the notes on the front page of our collection for our general fund income tax. For the month of February, we took in $72,993.97. The additional 0.5% police income tax levy brought in $36,496.98 for a total for the month of February and our income tax collection of $109,490.95. Can entertain any questions?
Council, Mr. Reynolds.
I just have a quick one. I see that we're renting a copier from the sheriff's office.
There's a copier lease. It was a contracted purchase that we, I believe it was at the end of 2015.
So, yes, my question was, did we ever look at how much it would be to buy a copier instead of continue leasing it?
Those contracts were put before you 2 years ago. I don't believe I have all the details.
I just was looking back and just was wondering, you know, if we could possibly look at that. I mean, I don't know how much a copier. I don't know if it's an industrial grade copier or if it's a one that you just buy. I know we had talked about it, I mean, previously, but.
So let me be clear. What was the question? What would you like me to
Just, I didn't know, like, how much that copier would be to purchase that style of copier instead of leasing it. Yeah. But Mr. Sergeant,
what's our the biggest reason we were leasing the copier was free maintenance for the equipment and the ink supply also. So that was the biggest reason. We spent several meetings discussing the copier also and what functions it had. At the present time, I would have liked to have it fax with it because you still fax a lot. And that was one of the capabilities at that time the county did want to have. So it doesn't have every option on it available. It has a staple, a couple other things. That might sound ridiculous to you, but we do generate a lot of paper for it.
Yeah. All right. That's my only question.
Thank you, sir. Council, any other questions or comments for
Colleen, I don't know if you have the answer to this, but I was in there today, you know, putting up a tax form, and Vicki and I was going back and forth. And she made a comment about this, about the checks that people are giving, and they aren't getting cash in a timely manner, but she said it will get better as time goes on. Do you know anything about that?
Which checks are you referring to? The income tax collection
yes.
checks?
Yes.
Since they go up to CCA up in Cleveland?
Right. And they said that, you know, now they're going, because they're all geared up now. But in the very beginning, they wasn't geared up. So there was, she said she had a couple citizens call that it took a month for their checks to clear.
Well, they just took over in January.
Right.
So I know that they had some issues taking the bulk of our software over and getting it compatible with theirs and then starting to collect. But the only input that I've had from her that was that it was getting a lot better. It just took some time to get it, our
Correct.
Software into their system so that they could start posting those payments.
Correct. And also we were talking about your Saturday classes for income taxes. You got one more coming?
We do. And it's going to be at the firehouse again, and I'm not sure if I have...
Say April 18th.
April 8th. April 8th.
What time?
Saturday.
8 till noon.
8 to noon?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
It was very successful last weekend.
I heard.
Good. Thank you, Mr. Craywalker. Council, anyone else? Thank you, Ms. Harris. We appreciate the report as always.
And moving on with the city manager's report, our service discussion with Mr. Kitko.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council, members of the public. Of a couple items here. One, we, due to the urbanized area that has been growing, Bethel Township has been in that, we are now considered an MS4 stormwater group. Basically, we are required now to have a national pollution elimination discharge permit. So with that, there is no cost, because we are going to, and I've already worked with the county to join their group along with Bethel and some of the other areas around, so we'll be a co-permittee under theirs. With that, I will be bringing to council sometime soon an ordinance adopting the sediment and erosion control and stormwater regulations that the county currently has. That was one of their things that they said we must adopt if we're going to be a co-permittee with them. And things like that would be if we're digging main breaks or if we have different, anything over an acre in disturbance, we'll have to make sure that those contractors will follow sediment and erosion control methods. So that's coming down the pipe. Otherwise, if we went on our own, it would cost us some additional money. So I just want everybody to be aware that we have another regulation we need to follow. The next thing is tomorrow, I know it may not get out to the folks on the camera, but there will be a closure a short time on Funston there at Main Street. The gas company is doing some major gas repairs in that area, and they need to shut that down. So they said about 2 hours. I'm going to go probably a half a day on normal construction, so I'll bear with them. I got them shutting it down at Scott Street, so they don't come down there and make U-turns. Got an update today on the Prentice Drive reconstruction, which was a CDBG critical infrastructure and development block grant that will be starting our surveys here this or next week, and I expect to have my plans available for bidding sometime by June 1st. The next item is we'll be sometime probably towards the end of this week. The deputy engineer and myself will be out looking in the Willowick area to get some estimates on some of our street levy repair work that will be done. So we're going to go out, see which ones will best maybe be an overlay. I doubt there will be any full reconstruction. Probably some curb and gutter work and storm work is that might be needed. Still working on alternative tower repair options, so I do not have any kind of update. I've been speaking with the city manager, Mr. Bridge, on that. And last, limb and brush pickup will begin in April. You'll be able to call in to the street department office at 845-3058 in the first week and to schedule a pickup for the second week. And usually our schedule starts on that Monday of that second week, and we're usually able to get them done all within a morning on that one Monday. You can schedule that, and that this is basically not for your full-blown tree removal. So if you have a tree removed by a company and have a pile out along the street, we are not going to be picking that up. This is for your basic people who have a little bit of brush, maybe do some of their own trimming of trees. Then they're supposed to be less than 4 inches on diameter. We do not have a large chipper. We're not made to do tree removal in a large fashion. And then bundles small, but that's coming up. There'll be more details on our page, website, and be some memos put out about that. And that is all I have.
Council?
I do.
Mr. Craybuck?
The American cleanup. You know when that is?
I'm not, we got the signs and everything for the
I know the signs are outside the government office, that's why.
I noticed I seen something on Facebook from one of the gentlemen I work with the Tecumseh Trail.
Matt Erler?
Yes. Yeah, with that group. He's had it out there and is trying to gather volunteers. I think we're trying. I already sent an email up to the sheriff's office to maybe get some assistance with pride workers. And not off the top of my head.
Okay. Can you explain to me, there's been some comments about when something goes out for bid, can you can you explain to me the procedure? Does everything go out for bid, or does a certain percentage of money, you know, go out for bid? How do you do that?
We follow the rules that have been provided towards Mr. Bridge, and I always give estimates on just about everything, unless it's a couple hundred bucks, maybe even up to a couple thousand dollars on it, especially if it's a proprietary or something. We usually don't go out, but when I start getting close to that 3,000 or 5,000 more, I will get some good proposals, but I still don't have to competitively bid. The ORC sets aside, depends on if it's a road project, if it's a building, like this tower, different things require different competitive bidding requirements. And even now, some of the ORC allows asset management that you can actually direct select on certain projects regardless of the cost.
Okay.
So there's a lot of factors going on what and how and when you competitively bid.
Okay, I've noticed, I was working in the garden, community garden the other day, and I noticed in the back of Madison, you know, you got a sign that says no dumping. Is that no dumping of anything? I noticed it's been cleaned up back there too. Can you?
Yeah, really it's no dumping for anything except for when we put a sign out there during leaf pickup and we allow leaf dumping. But we try to keep that alone because we have too many debris piles that by the time we get them out there have large concrete chunks, asphalt, metals, shards, debris from when we pump out with our pump truck. There's just too many hazards in there for people to be in there dumping, and you never know what they're dumping.
All right, that's fine.
Thank you, Mr. Craybacher. Mr. Lindsay.
The leaf pickup and the road closure, is that going to be up on the city website?
Did I say in the Facebook page? Lemon Rush, yes, that will be up on all our pages, the Facebook and then on the city website.
What about the road closure for tomorrow?
Absolutely. Sure.
Pardon me, sir?
You can put it on Facebook.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. Mr. Kitchell, I just had two. Could you touch on two things? You touched on one at the town hall, the road repairs that haven't been done because of the asphalt plants, like, for example, the plans that's going to happen in front of Water Dog. Can you just touch on that again? If you don't mind.
Just the Water Dog area, when we get asphalt rolling out of the plants, and that way we can schedule to go ahead and excavate that area out and get that repair done fully.
You're going to cut it down to the dirt and reef?
That's our plan right now. I mean, we haven't dug into any of it, but I'm kind of gearing at because of the water pumping up through the base.
Okay. And would you mind touching on a subject that was on the city's page about the flushable wipes? I know that was kind of a big...
I put that out at the last town hall and then asked to have that put out again. Well, it wasn't, I think, 2 or 3 days or this past Friday, my wastewater crews, I had to call them out because we had a backup in a manhole and it was backing up into a basement also. Well, there is a picture of a bucket full of flushable wipes, washcloths, wash rags, the Clorox wipes, any of those things. They say they're flushable. Those are what caused that manhole to overflow. So they are biodegradable when they're basically buried in a landfill down the road, but that could be 20, 30 years.
Right.
They just don't disintegrate like your toilet paper does in the main. They stay wholesale.
Okay, so nothing but toilet paper.
Right.
Thank you. Council, any other questions? Thank you, sir, appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Kitko. And moving on with our fire discussion, our fire chief, Chief Rusty.
Mayor, Council, Mr. Public. For the month of February, the New Carlisle Fire Division responded to 66 EMS calls in the city, 17 EMS calls in Elizabeth Township. The division responded to 12 fire-related calls in the city and 7 in Elizabeth Township. We had 2 EMS calls answered by mutual aid either by Pike Township or Bethel Clark due to Medic 52 being on response. We answered 1 mutual aid EMS call to Pike Township, 1 and 1 to Bethel Clark. Medic 52A was able to respond 3 times, which we put in our second medic out. In the month of February, the division responded to 11 overdoses, with 1 of those being a DOA. The new city tool, otherwise known as the Lucas tool, was put into service again. The division would like to thank everyone that made it possible for the purchase of the city tool. Assistant Chief Geiselman taught 3 CPR classes in the month of February for a total of 7 people. We received our 5 Marks radio, handheld radios. Those are in service, which gives us the capability to have a direct radio communication with Bethel Park Fire Division and Bethel Miami Division when they go on the Mark system. Bethel Park already is. When we're going mutual aid with them, now we have direct communication with them. And this way also too, when we're on scene, our crews, if they have to go inside, we don't have to depend on getting a handheld radio or something from that department. Our crews will be ready to go in as soon as they're on scene. Other than that, that's about it for the month. Any questions?
Council, Mr. Lindsay.
Chief, since we have the new Marx radios, do you have communication with the sheriff's office now?
No, sir.
We do not?
No, sir.
What would it take to make that happen?
We would have to have a template and the radios reprogrammed, but first off, we would have to have the permission of the sheriff to have that in our radios.
Do you normally have does the deputy normally respond on calls with you guys?
Only if it's requested by what? It depends on what the nature of the call might be.
And then you guys request that for your dispatch, or?
Only if we the dispatchers are usually pretty good about it. If it's a call that warrants law enforcement, they're usually pretty good about going ahead and sending them with us anyway. But if we need them, all we do is call our dispatch, which in turn, they have a direct line with county, and that they can get hold and respond with them. The sheriff and I, the sergeant and I were just talking this evening. What we're going to do is, to help with that a little bit, is all of our firefighters in their phones have what's called an active 911 system. And their phone alerts them every time we have a response. And what we're going to do is add our deputies' numbers to our active 911 system. So that way, they'll get the same alert at the same time we do. That way, if they feel, okay, I'm not doing anything, it's slow right now, I'll follow and see if they need a hand. More than not, our deputies are usually right behind us. Even if it's not a call requiring a deputy, they show up, hey, you guys need a hand, can we help?
So. I was looking at the safety aspect to having contact with at least the dispatcher, the SO dispatcher. You know, you guys hit an awful lot of heroin runs. You get into various things. I think for safety aspect, I don't know what the rest of council thinks or what Mr. Bridge thinks, but I think if what you're putting in place now does not work properly or the way it should, I think maybe we should look into having direct contact with at least the sheriff dispatchers in case you need a deputy ASAP. You know, it goes out to whoever, you know.
It's a big communication issue right now, especially with the fact, yes, we have 5 Marks handheld radios, but we are not, as the city of New Carlisle, on the Marks system as far as a whole, where the deputies in the county are on the Marks system.
Right.
So there's a lot of communication along with that which has to be done.
I, for one, think we should look into getting our fire department personnel, if nothing else, a channel in the medics and an engine, or in the battalion unit. In case something happens, we can get a deputy there to back you guys up if one isn't already on the scene. I know from my fire department days, we had an officer on every run we went on. They would pull up, they'd come in. If we told them we was good, they'd leave. If we told them we hang around, they'd hang around. It all goes back to safety for you guys.
Oh, I agree.
You all do a heck of a job, and I hate to see one of you get hurt because somebody comes up out of an induced coma or whatever, and you give them Narcan, and all of a sudden they want to cold cop somebody. So I think, from my standpoint, I'd like to have Mr. Bridge look into that if Russell Council agrees with that or is on board with that. You know, I don't know what it would cost, I don't know what it would take, but I'd like to have more information on that.
Well, the biggest thing is the radio systems that are on the apparatus right now are VHF radios.
Mm-hmm.
They would be unable to put a Marks channel in a VHF radio.
Correct.
That just don't marry. Me and the city manager have been talking, we're trying to push toward us going to the Marks system by next year, hopefully. Under the all departments are supposed to be on Marks system by 2019. Whether that's going to hold true or not, as far as they're going to enforce that or not, I don't know. But we're going towards that, and along with that, going to the Marks system. That was one of our points that we wanted to put into it, is getting with the Sheriff's Department, and we don't feel we really want all of our handhelds, because on the fire apparatus now, when we go to a marked system, every writing position of the apparatus has to have a radio. We really don't feel that every one of those radios need to have a capability with the Sheriff's Department, but what we would look to do is put it with all three of the chief's handhelds and also in the battalion vehicle.
Okay.
That way, but and that's one of the things we've already discussed and looked to do with one to two systems. And every year we put in for the Marks radio grants and that type of thing. They're very expensive. One Marks handheld is over $6,000.
So right now you don't have any way of communicating with any other department?
We can communicate
even through like the inner city channel or something?
Only other channel that we can do is if you go to the countywide mutual aid channel, and that's a patch system, which is okay. We can communicate with Pike Township, they're also VHF. Bethel Park is on the MARC system. Now with our five handhelds that we have, we can communicate with them now. I just got an email this afternoon. The Miami County MARC system will not go in effect now until April 13th, and which we will have communications with them, with the five MARC radios, plus also to the battalion vehicle. We'll have a MARC mobile in it as of next week, which was acquired by the Miami County by them going to the MARC system and our battalion vehicle responding with Elizabeth Township on every call. We acquired a MARC mobile for that piece of apparatus.
Okay. I would just like to have some.
Absolutely.
Have you look into that and let me know what the progress of it or whatever. If council has to agree to do all this, I would say, or you might be able to make that decision.
I can take care of that for you, absolutely.
All right,
I think it's very well warranted to look into that.
Thank you. Yep.
Thanks, sir. Mr. Reynolds.
I had a quick follow-up. When we first did the MARC radios on my first term with the Sheriff's Department, we were told this was like interchangeable with all departments because after September 11th, it was federally mandated. So I was under the assumption that it automatically connected directly with the Sheriff's Office, but it doesn't now. So, okay. Because that was like the whole selling point of it, was interchangeable with everybody.
It is that everyone is supposed to be there by 2019.
Okay. Just right now, not everyone's there.
The money's not there.
It's true.
Yeah, like I said, when you're looking, the only reason Miami County did it, they got a countywide grant.
Okay.
And we tried two different ways last year to get a grant for us for the MARC. Our state, or the state fire, is looking at it that they're looking at any county that has two or three small departments that aren't MARCs yet, that if they give them that grant, it'll make that entire county MARCs whole. And if they don't fit that criteria, they're not getting the grant. Where in Clark County, we have more departments in Clark County that are not MARCs than that are MARCs.
Oh, wow.
Right now, the only two that I'm definite positive that are MARCs is Bethel Fire and Springfield Township.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reynolds. I just have one question. Is that common for departments to have communication with the fire department and the police?
It was the biggest problem that they found in the 9/11 incident, that there was no communication crossability between fire, EMS, police, Port Authority, or anyone. No one could talk to each other.
Okay.
Okay. The MARC system was an answer for everybody.
Okay. Mr. Lindsay?
I just wanted to follow up on the mayor's question to you. When I was on the fire department and the tornado hit in Xenia, I think it was in 70.
71.
Yes.
No,
74. Yeah. We had a channel back then that all the departments in, I know Montgomery County, we had an inner city channel. And when that hit, everybody went to the inner city channel and everybody could talk to somebody else. Whether it was on your portable and any piece of equipment, the radio I had in my car even had it. I don't know why that ever went away, or if they renamed it, or if it just cost too much for everybody to stay up. And again, it was, VHF, I think is what it was. It was like a dinosaur
VHF,
radio system.
It was the bands that they used before VHF,
right,
then they went to VHF. And then it went to that there was, it became a flood of different types of radio systems.
Right.
You had the 800 system, the 700 system, the VHF system, and it was whatever department, whatever that department wanted to use.
And that may have stopped when the 800 systems came out, because I know Van Dale went to it.
There's still a countywide mutual aid channel that everybody can go to. As a matter of fact, there's a statewide
mutual
aid channel that everybody can go to.
Okay.
But again, that's on the Mark system.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. Council, any other questions, comments? Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Chief, Trustee. And moving on with the manager's report, our Sergeant Underwood, our police administrator.
Thank you, Bridge, Council, audience. Just to kind of sum up on the Mark's radios, I was also around back in those days, and because of 9/11, actually in the United States, they're eventually going to mandate everyone to be on the same channel, or have access to the same channels. But because of the millions of dollars it is going to cost, they're spreading that out over a time period. And some agencies were able to jump on board early, and some were not. But at some point in time, that will be mandated, or they will not have radio service. Now, another thing that you got to think about, if you want to buy 15 radios, each radio has to have a license, and there is a monthly fee associated with it. So you just can't leave a radio sit around. You're talking $6,000 or plus for a radio, and then you have basically a lease on it for that license. So, a lot of things to think about when it comes to that. But it is getting better, and I might be wrong, but Chief, anytime we have someone up here in the area and there's a call about Narcan,
any overdose, anything that has anything to do with domestic.
We're there.
Our crews are already mandated on an overdose or anything domestic. They don't go to the scene until law enforcement or something.
So it's pretty good, but it's going to get a lot better.
Okay.
With that, I'll start my February report. And during the month of February, the weather was kind to us. Neck after vehicle crashes down considerably, and it really did. And thank you for slowing down in adverse weather. That helps us all. And if you've never had a crash, and even though it's a fender bender, it's a nightmare for you just by contacting your insurance company and trying to get the car repaired. So other than being hurt, there's a whole lot that goes along with those. So I just want to thank everyone for paying attention to their driving. Our new Corral deputies have been out on patrol checking businesses, and the new Corral Elementary School. Along with that, we're taking 67 calls for service, and that's not the building checks and the things go on. That's not listed. I wanted to bring this up because sometimes we forget about it. We have DARE officers in the county. Deputy Josh Berner is teaching DARE, six DARE classes once a week at our elementary school here. And Deputy Sean Lyle, who's our other DARE officers, is making visits with Deputy Berner when he's not out teaching himself. Deputy Scott Kaltheis is the district school resource officer, and he is in and out of the elementary school on a regular basis. So our school down here, we have, at any given week, 3, 4, 5 deputies just in and out of the school. And we go in, we announce ourselves, we let the office know we're there. We don't even want our deputies going in unannounced. So we want to make sure everybody's aware of that. Then at the first part of February, Deputy Jeff Boswell transferred back into the Clark County Jail, and Deputy Cesar Gonzalez came out into the city. Deputy Gonzalez has worked in the Uniform Patrol Division for Clark County, and he'll be welcome to the new Corral as a late shift deputy. Deputy Gonzalez also speaks several different versions of Spanish, and is able to communicate with some that couldn't communicate with us. And I've worked with those people. It's very scary for them because they are taught that we're very bad, evil people, and some of you might even think that. We really try not to. We really are here as your friend to try to help you. So Deputy Gonzalez, he's a great, great young man. I think you'll do great up here. And then I spoke with the city manager about getting another quote for the patrol car that caught fire. And we took the car out of service due to a complaint of irritation from the fire extinguisher residue. The quote from ServPro was $466.04. And after the car was cleaned, we were able to put that car back in service. And to this date, I've not received any complaints about a smell in the car, which is fantastic. That put us another car out that we can use for control, and now each deputy has a car, and that is a big plus. And we have a, what's it, 2002? Yeah, we have a 2002 Ford Crown Vic, simply with low mileage on it, because we were able to each deputy have a car. So it does truly make them last longer when they have individual cars, and they take a lot better care of them. And then on Friday, March 17th, there was a special drug task force that did a sweep in Bethel Township and Nicolau. The drug sweep involved many different police agencies, and it was very successful. I hope to have that actual statistical information soon. It was just not available for me at the time I done this. And it's the first day of spring. I hope you enjoyed it. With that, I'll entertain any questions that you may have.
Council? Questions? Mr. Craybaugh.
Can you read that last paragraph again?
On
the task force?
Okay. On Friday, March 17th.
Nice and loud. I don't want to hear people say that we're not doing anything.
Oh, this is one of many of them. We have our problems. Each community has their problems. But you're going to see more of these sweeps. And we had Springfield K-9 units up here, Springfield Police Department for K-9 units up here. We had the Highway Patrol. We had the DEA. I mean, it was all of us working together. And we all have one common denominator. That stopped the guy with the drugs. And hopefully, there'll be many more of those until we can actually get a grip on this problem. So,
okay.
And to answer your question you gave me earlier.
Oh, yeah, about the Good Samaritan Law.
The Good Samaritan Law, I was able to look it up real fast.
Good.
It doesn't take effect till September of this year. And there's going to be a Good Samaritan Law that allows a person who's overdosed some amnesty for a period of time, or people that are with them some amnesty for a period of time. But there's a lot of restrictions with that, and it's probably going to be a complicated law for us at first, but that's going to take place in September.
So that's in September? Okay. Because Channel 7 had a thing with Clark County, mm-hmm. and that's why I was asking, about that. I just wanted to say that a few of us went to Narcan class in down in Montgomery County, and so with that in Montgomery County they have a thing called the Dawn Project, and in the Dawn Project you can get free Narcan, from the Samaritan Crisis Health, but you have to go through training first, to do it, and it's also by prescription. However, I was talking to the CVS pharmacist up here. And the pharmacist is allowed to write the prescription as long as you go through the training first. But we asked about the price of Narcan, and it's almost $150. It's $140 and some change, for that. That's for the 4 milligram, that goes through the nose, and you get 2 hits, with that. So it's pretty expensive. They say some insurances cover it, and some do not. And hopefully we'll have more information forthcoming.
The chief told us last meeting, we had one individual up here at one time took 10 rounds.
And
10?
10.
At $150, you figure that out.
And it's not uncommon for 3, 4, 5.
Yeah, yeah. I even asked at the training, is 2 going to be enough? So they said sometimes it's not. And they said the same thing. But what I also asked about the Samaritan Law, they said if you administer Narcan, you have to call 911. If you do not call 911, something about you're liable, I don't know. Okay. But they said that you can be liable for that person's health, after that.
but you have to first call 911. And by the time you get to the second dose, they're supposed to be there. And then we turn it over to the emergency.
I'm sure the reason behind that is that it does wear off. So if they do not go to the hospital, they can still die.
Yeah, still.
It's like we're calling the force to catch them in this situation. In our hand, they come out of it, they're coherent. They can say, no, I don't want to go.
And just for everybody out here, I see a lot of young people. The very first sign of overdose is they stop breathing. Narcan is supposed to increase breathing, you know, supposed to start your breathing. So if you see somebody who looks like they're taking a nap, but their lips are turning blue, it might be a drug addict or their first hits, and you know, you need to get help right away.
We actually had a person Friday night that they at first thought they were passed out, and it ended up they were on an overdose and issued Narcan to
it. Mm-hmm. It's become all the paramedics work on what's called protocol, a very minor valid protocol. Any person that is under witness arrest, in other words, they're not breathing, then no one can say, well, they had a heart attack, anything under witness, one of those drugs is in the protocol.
Right. It's better to be safe than sorry. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Craywalker. Council, anyone else? Mr. Lindsay. Oh, sorry. Thank you. Thanks.
You wasn't looking that way.
Thank you. Sergeant Zimmerman, does the police force in town still carry and use phrasilators? Because you talked about Deputy Gonzalez coming here and the language barrier. Do we still have those?
No, they did not live up to what they were supposed to.
Okay.
You still needed. They didn't work like what they should.
Okay, good enough. That's what I was wondering. Thank you very much.
And those are that was probably 6 years ago now.
Yeah, that was a high dollar item. I think Fab Meadows donated one that cost like $5,000.
Yes.
What was it called?
Phrasilators.
They were supposed to. We could speak into the machine, and they were supposed. The machine was supposed to take what we say and turn it into Spanish.
Right. So,
and vice versa, and it never met expectations.
Save your snap on your phone.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't know that. Okay.
So all our paramedics have it on their phone, and just use it in the back of the medical ward.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay.
I just wanted to let everybody know the other Friday night when they did the blitz in Bethel Township, New Carlisle, Springfield, I had the pleasure of riding with Deputy Gonzalez. We were here in New Carlisle. He is, as he told me, he's almost like Deputy Beller, if you know who he is. But he's just under Deputy Beller. He has a knack for driving by a car and knowing something's wrong with that car. And he made quite a few stops. On a couple of them, it wasn't what he was expecting. So he only wrote warnings or given verbal warnings, and he did write one citation. I don't know what the other deputy that was on duty that night in the blitz did. I heard that they did make a couple of busts here in town, and I believe Deputy Fader was involved in that, which is one of our, he's a detective, excuse me. He was involved in that. I forget the address that they did that on. I probably couldn't say it if I did know.
Yeah, he was on patrol up here for many years.
Yes.
So he's well aware.
But they did an awesome job the other night. I commented to the sheriff that they need to, you know, I'd like to see this happen at least once a month. And if they had the funds or the grants to do that, we could pretty much run heroin out of this city, out of this township, fairly quick. Like the chief said, they had, four or five agencies involved in it. And some of these federal guys, to talk to them, they're real nice, but man, when you tell them it's time to go to work, you don't even recognize them. They have a complete different persona, don't they, Sarge?
They do. It's
someone I wouldn't want to run into.
No. they did an excellent job from what I've seen and what I was involved with. And I hope we have more to come.
So for the young people out here, it's for us, it's all about education. And you're about that age now where you're thinking about, well, is education worth it? You must have education. As a law enforcement, we are mandated by Ohio to go to school a lot and keep our certifications going. So if you're interested in law enforcement, you'll never get away from going out, not going to school. It's always there. Same thing with the fire department.
Council, any other questions? Thanks, Sergeant Underwood.
Thank you, Sergeant Underwood. And moving on with the city manager's report, we'll go over the informational items. Ohio checkbook, we are finally ready for our hard launch date, and that is for April 3rd. That'll be 2 weeks from now. We did have some issues with usability and some how some things were titled. It has been a little crazy in the past couple weeks, so I think moving it forward 2 weeks is the best date. We will have someone visit us here at the council meeting, and we'll go through that launch procedure as we were going through before. We'll get the media involved. I got a quilt set for them, so we're very excited to get that launch because it really does allow you to get in there and finagle our finances and really break it down how you want to see fit by fund item, by item type. So we are very excited to launch that out for our citizens. We just had to take some time to make sure it was actually correct and a lot more user-friendly than what it was originally supplied to us for.
Time to turn over.
I don't like it when it cuts off too long. I lose you.
Are you ready to go?
Yes.
All right. Bell Manor, we did have a meeting on 3/17 of 17. I did at that point in time inquire about more operating expenses on their behalf. I would like to see some numbers that they may produce for us. We will have a meeting tomorrow with our city attorney, not this one, with Jake Jeffries, who's helping us out with an MOU. We will be signing that MOU tomorrow. Once that is signed, the transfer date will be set 3 months out. The MOU is non-binding. So what that means is we will actually still have an out 7 days prior to that date of transfer. The asbestos survey will take up to 5 weeks to get the results. This will leave approximately 2 months for council to further engage their citizens on the donation. We did hire an additional part-time code enforcement officer on 3/13 of 17. Her name is Christy Smith, so please welcome her to the new Carlisle family. And we do need to address many code violations, so very excited to have two code enforcement officers in the field, and hopefully we can get the ground running with some of our more problematic properties. That is all I have for the city manager's report. We'll be happy to entertain any questions.
Mr. Bridge, would you explain to the audience what the MOU abbreviation stands for, please?
Memorandum of Understanding.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Craybacher.
I know in the last meeting, a lot of people was asking about Bell Manor. And I just want 2 minutes of everybody's time. You know, they want information that, one, we don't have yet because it's too early. You know, we had a citizen who wanted, you know, a profit and loss statement. Well, we can't, you know, it'd be really hard to do a profit and loss statement at this time because, well, one way, at that time, we didn't even have Bell Manor. We don't really have it in our hands yet, you know. And so we can always do estimates, but sometimes it's going to be, you know, how many people is going to be rented? You know, supposedly we have, you know, 100% rental. You know, that would be a great thing, but we don't know. You know, we don't know. I know Randy and I talked about utilities, you know, a little bit earlier today, you know, and how much utilities are. And he's just getting that information. So starting the profit and loss statements, that'd be kind of hard to do, I would think. You know, I know when I ran a business, profit and loss statements, after the first year, I can give you a whole lot better guess, you know, on that. You know, Randy has been talking to people to come and rent offices or office space. And there are several that are very interested. I'm not going to say who, because I don't want to jinx it. You know, I want it to happen that way. They say, what other questions? There were just a lot of questions. We are trying to do counsel along with Randy, are trying to do our due diligence, you know, and finding out information, know. But it's early. This is early in the ballgame. It's not late in the ballgame. Like you said, the memo of understanding, there is a way out still if he sees, you know, or we happen to come across something that we can actually push it out. You know, so do we need it? I'm going, you know, if you've ever been back in beyond the lobby, I do think we need more space. I said when we moved in there, we need more space. So that's my, did I have 5 minutes yet?
You're good.
I'm good.
Thank you, sir. Randy, I had one quick question for you. On the online checkbook, I could not remember. It just hit me while we were here. I would have asked you sooner. What kind of costs were associated with that?
Cost?
Yeah, is there?
No, there's none, not at this point in time.
Okay. Yep. None in the future? I just couldn't remember.
Just cost for us to kind of review it and all that stuff, but there's no charge for us to be coming up with that. No, that was Josh Mendel's way to get the state of Ohio to be super transparent.
Right.
Which worked, because they went from like 46 to 2.
Okay.
In the nation, so.
Right.
Yep.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Council, Mr. Reynolds.
Just to follow up on the checkbook, I know that we talked about this for now for quite a while. I'm happy it's happening. And I know we got the mass confusion last time of where it would be held, you know, and the launch because they got confused.
Yes.
So I'm definitely looking forward to it. And I think it's going to be great. I mean, I don't know if you've ever been to the website, any of you have, you can type in. A great example is my favorite one to use, actually. If you go to the OhioOpenCheckbook.gov and you type in Victoria's Secret, you will find out how many state agencies bought gift cards to Victoria's Secret. State agencies, this is your tax dollars going to buy gift cards for a lingerie shop. I mean, it's quite astonishing. 120,000 if you want to know. I looked that up the other day. So you can literally type in anything and find out where they spend the money. Yeah.
Victoria's Secret.
Yeah, gift cards for employees to the Ohio Department of, the Ohio Board of Cosmetology.
You will not see that under the city of New Carlisle.
Thank you, sir.
That was going to be my question to him.
All right. Is that any other questions, Council, for Mr. Bridge? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bridge. And we'll move on to comments from the members of the public. This is your guys' time. Do you have any questions or comments? And we have a lot of people here tonight, so let's try and keep them in that 5 minute range if possible. If you have any questions or comments, please go up to the podium and give your name and address for us.
Hi, I'm Leanna Davidson. I live at 304 North Adams Street. I'd actually sent all of the council members or added them to an email that I had sent Mr. Bridge about waste management. My issue is I was paying $42 and some odd cents for service, which was for the large tote and unlimited bags. The only condition was that I had to put those extra bags in my own containers. So 10 years ago when I moved into the city from Park Lane, I went out and bought additional containers and put my trash in there every week. I have a household of 7. Now with the new contract, I fill that tote weekly, and in the event that for some reason I forget to set the trash out, or recently I called waste management because I was cleaning out my garage and asked if I could put those additional items out and was told, yes, as long as you bag them up, we'll make a note, but that's not the case anymore. So if my children have birthdays or we have Christmas, I'm out of luck. I pay now $49 because our price went up and my service is less. And I understand that the city looks at what's best for the residents, but what's best for you isn't best for me. So I don't know what options were looked at. I know that bids went out and that's what made the final decision, but at the end of the day, if I miss my trash, I'm going to have to go pay in order to have it disposed of when I have, you know, a monthly expense already in the budget. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to rent another container that I'm not going to use 90% of the time, so it makes no sense for me to do that. At the end of the day, if I have to cancel my service altogether and drive 8 minutes to my parents in Park Lane and split their trash bill, then that's what I might have to do. Which seems silly because I've lived here for 10 years and never had an issue, but at what time do we decide that the contract isn't working? You know, I'm 30 years old now, and when I was in high school and had to sit here as these students have to for their, you know, service hours, I never thought that I would have to come just to discuss what seems like a small issue, but many people aren't going to come up here to talk about it. They're just going to deal with it.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's, and thank you for coming tonight. We saw your, I think your email was passed everyone on council, so everyone saw your email. So thank you for that. Thank you for coming tonight. You know, as you touched on, when we put this bid out, only two people would put in for the contract. It was Waste Management and Rumpke. And Rumpke was, I wouldn't say considerably higher, but they were a little bit higher than Waste Management. And, you know, I think Randy did it. I mean, me personally, I think he did a good job of looking at other communities and seeing what other kind of contracts people were utilizing in other towns to see what would fit best. I mean, I know that not everybody's happy with the contract, but I also know that there are people that like the way it is. So it's one of those, it's kind of a catch-22. I mean, you're not going to be able to please everybody, but at the same time, you know what I'm saying?
Which is understandable.
Now, I'm sorry. Can we touch on, and if you'd rather not yet until it's actually delivered, can we touch on what Mimi was going to check out the other day?
Oh, by all means, yeah.
Okay, sure. something to help with, and this came as a suggestion from one of the citizens and thought it was a great idea, and that was a great thing. Come from on the other side of this table, which is great when someone gets involved. He'd come to us and said that a lot of other cities have recycling bins that they're free to use for the citizens. For example, like Christmas time, and everybody has a ton of boxes built up. I mean, I fill my shirt up every year. And so what we're gonna do is, free of service and Waste Management is gonna provide it, we're gonna put a recycling bin down by the pool, so when people do have a lot of extra cardboard, a refrigerator box or whatever it is, you know, that you may have, you can go down there and just put it in there and get rid of it, and not have to go through two or three cycles of tearing boxes up to get them into your one can. So I think that was a good idea, and it was one way to kind of show that, you know, we understand the problem with it, which, you know, I think it was great, really.
So with the contract being changed, like I said, my service didn't change, or my service changed, my price went up, but yet my service itself went down. I can no longer sit. I know the issue was the blowing trash, but if we were all using our containers like we were supposed to and putting them in additional containers that we bought, then that still wouldn't have been an issue.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Lindsay.
If I understand our contract completely, they are using a robotic arm now to pick these cans up and dump them. I know the cans that you're talking about. I have some too that, you know, I can't even use them for a paperweight that you like. But the arm will absolutely destroy the cans that you bought because they're not heavy enough. I don't know how much another can would be. I don't know if we could, some of the citizens have complained about this. You know, they have large families. Would it be possible to maybe work something out with Waste Management to get a little cheaper rate on a second container for an existing customer that is having this problem or not? I don't know.
The cost of a container is $2.50 a month. To answer your question, we cannot change the terms of the bid. That was a legally binding bid that we bid it out, so unfortunately the contract is what it is. And if I could add something, and I understand your situation, we in the city and our codified ordinances cannot have bags, trash placed in bags outside of the container. It has to be in a container with a lid. So that's why the bags went away. So we had the yellow bags, people just come up by the city building, but we couldn't do that. Well, I did get a cost to just continue on with the current contract that we had. The price of the bags was going up like $8 or $9 a bag, and then your monthly service was going to skyrocket as well. What happened was, people using those yellow bags, they were supposed to share one. If I live here, you live there, we're all supposed to have our own bags. But what happened was, neighbors would share one bag. So Waste Management ended up losing a lot of money off the cost of that contract. So only way to get a fair price was to obviously take the bags out, go to the automated thing. But we really had to look at a community of 6,000. And we are a diverse community of 6,000 with different kind of family makeups.
Right.
So we generally had to do a tiered system, what you pay for what you use. And that's why we have these small containers for our senior citizens, a mid-sized container, and a large container. The cost to rent an additional tote at $250 a month,
is very, very, very reasonable. I understand your situation. I do feel for you, but the contract was changed again to make it better for the community as a whole. When you do something like that, unfortunately, it's going to affect someone negatively, and it's going to affect other people positively at the same time. So I think the current contract goes for 3 years, 4 years at that point in time. We are note-taking all of the issues that we'll have, and for the next time around, we'll try to bid it out a little differently. But it is a state, we had to bid it out. So if we go back and do that, we had some concerns probably a month afterwards after it started. Mm-hmm. You know, and we had possibly looked into that. But it would cost a lot of money to go back through there. And I'll be honest with you, if we would have had maybe four or five companies come back and bid, throw their bids out, great, we might be able to pull that off. But right now I feel as though we're going to get with Rumpke. And Rumpke was quite a bit higher, very much so higher, you know. So it was a very tough time to write that new contract. I looked at a lot of different municipalities across the state of Ohio, you know, and everybody, it all came back down to a tiered system, pay for what you use. And that's where we're at now.
And can I just add one thing?
Sure.
When I had called Waste Management after they told me they were picking up my trash and didn't, I was told that the price of the tote was $8.50. I was not given the price that you replied with in your email.
Yeah, it's $2.50.
So, okay.
Yeah. The $8.50 price probably could have been the quarter, because it's $2.50 a month that you pay quarterly. So if you times that by three, that gets you around that $7.50, $8.50 range.
Okay.
Plus taxes and all that.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
That's my question.
Wait a minute.
Mr. Lowry?
Can I answer a question? Will the dumpster help at all?
Recycling?
Like for a birthday party, take all your boxes?
It wouldn't. I mean, the biggest concern is if I forget to put the trash out. There's mm-hmm. many times I go to work at 6 o'clock in the morning because I work at Victoria's Secret.
Mr. Bridge, the price that you had mentioned to her, the two what?
$2.50.
Is that for the biggest one or is that for?
I think it is for the biggest one.
Okay, so then the medium one would be cheaper, I'm assuming, right?
No, because the whole point of the medium one is for a level billing for people who have two or three people. You can only get the extra container if you're on the biggest tiered system you get with.
Okay,
yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Yep. Our county garage is right next door to one of those recycling centers. And deputies, we talk, it is constant flow of traffic coming in and out using the recycle center. You can reduce your trash to about a third, actually, probably even less than that, if you're able to use the recycling center. It's amazing how it's even grown since they've started it. So that's a great thing for the city of New Carlisle. It takes a while to catch on, but.
Thank you, Sergeant. Counsel?
Just real quick, Mr. Just real quick, I was in St. Louis last week. Spent the night in St. Louis. And anyway, turned on the news, and what were they talking about? Trash, of all things. And people were complaining that, you know, they were asking why did they go with the lowest bidder? Instead of, you know, because they went with a higher bidder, and people complaining about why. And the reason was the lowest bidder was not reliable. That's exactly what they said, you know, in the news broadcast. So, heck if you do and heck if you don't.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else in the audience? Comments or questions? This is your moment. All right, thank you. Moving on to committee reports, none tonight. Resolutions are zero, and ordinances. Mr. Collier.
Ordinance 17-11E, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance to establish appropriations for current expenses and other expenditures of the City of New Carlisle, State of Ohio during the fiscal year ending December 31st, 2017, and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion for ordinance 17-11E.
Councilman, you want a second?
Second.
And explanation of this ordinance is to establish our annual appropriations for the year. This is mandated by the state of Ohio, Ohio Revised Code, that we do have this certified to the county auditor no later than April 1st of this year. I would like to make a short note. There has been discussion about the water rate increase. Those numbers that are in that budget now, it is at that 20, 10, and 5, but I will stress to the audience and the council members, it doesn't matter really what number is in there. The water rates will not change until they amend the ordinance that dictates those water rates. So we're still on hold with that, but it is an absolute necessity that this budget passes and we get these numbers certified to the county. If we do not do that tonight, we will have to call a series of special meetings in the future to get that done before April 1st. But we are looking at a possible shutdown of the city services if this does not pass and does not approve by April 1st to the county. So our situation at that point will be much more dire than the situation we're discussing about our water rates.
Thank you, sir. Mm-hmm. Council, any questions or comments before we go to a vote? Mr. Krabacher.
Question is that, and I think I know the answer, but we can change at any time during the year. Because we've done that many times.
You can change your appropriations as long as there's money to be spent. You can't spend money that you don't have. That is the only prohibition on an appropriation.
Well, the government does. What can't
we? You must, in the state of Ohio, you must have money in order to spend it.
But we do multiple amending
as a municipality. Otherwise, you are free to change your appropriations at any time. Yes.
Mr. Lowry?
Oh, okay. Well, also with saying that, you can change it to spend more if you can have it, but you can also turn around and go the other way and say, I'm allotted, let's say $50, and I'm only going to spend $25, correct?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, you may change either way. The only prohibition is that you may not spend money that you don't have.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Lowry. Mr. Reynolds?
I talked about this during our budget meetings. I suggested several cuts. We transferred monies around. I definitely wasn't in favor of the budget, but after a legal opinion and then contacting the state and county auditor's office, if we don't have it, if we don't pass it, we can't spend money, period. So this county auditor said, oh, you can spend in reserves. The state auditor said, you can't spend, period. And the state auditor said, well, you technically could, but the problem would be if you did that, what happens if someone decides to press upon your city to take you to court, and then you're in some serious trouble because then we're going to be paying her more money than we already pay her now, which is still a lot. But she does a good job for us, so I'm okay with that. But so I think that even though I would like to see definitely some changes to it, we're going to have to vote for it, or no police, no fire, no water. What is it, 3 days, Howie, is what we have in the water tank?
Yeah.
And to amend it, and if we were to fail us tonight, according to the city charter, we had to have that 14-day period to review the budget. It's one of our sections. So we would actually fall 6 days outside of the thing. So we only have 3 days worth of water. So I don't really plan on bathing in a creek. So I'm voting for this.
After tonight, just stand out.
I can just go that. That's true.
Mr. Mayor, I guess if I could clarify for the public, the way you address these issues, if you're not happy with what you have, is that you call a work session and you iron out any difficulties that you have. There's no reason to have a last minute emergency. You can always work and tinker on your appropriations at any time council wants to. You work as a group to work it out. You don't have to come up to the wire and have any last minute emergency. So you just work as a group, and you can do that at any time that you want to leading up to this. The deadline never changes. You always have to have your appropriations to the county by April 1st. This has always been the law, and it remains the law. And you just instruct the manager to get your work session scheduled, and that's what you do. So then you can have your meeting, and you work out what you need to, and that's your obligation and your charter as council members. So there isn't anything that has changed on this topic. It's been the same forever.
Thank you, ma'am.
There's no ambiguity about it, is what I want to make clear.
Okay. Thank you. Council, any other questions or comments before we move on?
One real quick comment. When we were talking in the work session and the second budget meeting, I didn't make the first one, so I don't know what happened there. We were very polite. We listened to each other, you know, and I thought we worked very well.
Oh, I mean, I would respond. I mean, I would have liked to have seen some cuts. I mean, and I didn't wait till last minute to voice my reservations. I had voiced it to Mr. Bridge about certain things. And during the meeting, I asked for certain cuts that weren't given. So to say I waited last minute would be a falsehood. But I think that second meeting, though, we definitely talked. We're honest. We're very sincere. And I thought we worked together well. I mean, we all have differences. We all have different political persuasions and different ways about going about changing the city or making it I hate to say the phrase great again or if it's always great now, you never know from people's point of view. But I mean, we all had an honest, sincere discussion. So I definitely appreciated that during the second round of budgeting.
Thank you, Mr. Reynolds. Mr. Lindsay.
To tap off of John, Mr. Krebacher, the second round of budget talks that we had, the first comment I made of that meeting is, once everything is said and done, I would like to see a flat 10% reduction in all departments. And the response I got, I think it was a joke. I'm not sure. It was probably it's true what was said to me. And I, for one, am not in favor of this. But I agree with Mr. Reynolds that we have to pass this, because we only have 3 days of water. Unless this town wants to go dry, now's the time for you all to let us know how you want this to go. We work for you. We don't work for the city manager. We don't work for the attorney. We don't work for nobody over there. We work for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. I'll just go on with that. Yeah, I think on the second meeting we did, we had a good meeting. And as Mr. Reynolds said, you know, you don't always get a or you don't always agree, I should say, on some cuts that some people say. On what Mr. Lindsay had said, you know, that he was looking for a 10% across the board. I mean, that's a great thought, and this is just my opinion. And to ask for that is fair to ask for, but I think as a council member, you also need to be responsible and say, okay, I want a 10%, this is where I see how you should do it. I don't think if you took 10% off of our budget, we wouldn't probably be here in a year, because the city couldn't operate with 10% cut straight across the board. That's my opinion. I mean, if you're talking about cutting 10% off of every department, wages, I don't know where, somewhere where you work, and if someone comes up to you and says, well, I'm gonna take 10% of your paycheck, I doubt you're gonna be there much longer. That is just my opinion. I don't think there's a lot of fluff in this budget. You look at the city of New Carlisle's vehicles and trucks and things like that. We stretch our equipment as far as we can. We just recently purchased a vacuum truck, if I'm calling it the right piece of equipment, because the one we had before that was 30, 40 years old, maybe even older. So, we all have our different opinions and concerns, but I think it came out pretty good, in my opinion. Council, any other comments, questions? Mr. Collier, Mr. Lowry.
Since this is an ordinance and before it's voted on, I would request that you ask if anybody in the audience who has heard these conversations have any questions.
That could get into really detailed questions. I mean, they don't.
What does the rules of council say?
Right, I don't know what the rules of council says.
Question about the ordinance?
Yes.
They want to open up discussion about this ordinance. So they had two work sessions already passed the reading.
They can make any changes during the fair.
By the way,
we can open it up if they'd like, legally.
I just wondered if anybody had any questions. And I think if they do, they should be allowed to ask
them. All right. If anybody in the audience has any questions on the budget, this would be your moment.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Lowry. All right, Mr. Collier, when you're ready, sir.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Lethley.
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugh.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Leidy.
Yes.
Ordinance 1711E passes 7-0.
Thank you, sir. Moving on.
Ordinance 17-12, this is an introduction tonight. Introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 4317. An ordinance amending the City of New Carlisle's use of the city-owned vehicle policy.
All right. Then moving on to other business.
Give me 2 seconds.
Yes, sir.
Crime Watch meeting will be held on Wednesday, April the 8th, beginning at 6:30 p.m. here at Smith Park Shelter House. That is open to the public. And as we announced in previous meetings, Congressman Warren Davison will hold mobile office hours at our city building on the fourth Tuesday of each month, 8 p.m. to 2:30 p.m.
Thank you, sir. Before we move down to the executive session, I just wanted to mention the New Carlisle Pool will be opening this summer, and they are looking for lifeguards with a lot of the young students in here. If anyone is interested in lifeguards, I think there's also a couple options for classes that may be forming to get certified. But if anyone's interested, shoot the New Carlisle Pool Facebook page a message, or stop by the city building, or give the city building a call, and they can point you in the right direction if anyone is interested to be a lifeguard.
Do you know what age?
Howie, the age?
Thank you.
16, I think, from
15? 15.
April.
15 and up. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
We're going to have another good year at that pool.
Yes, we are.
We are.
Another good year.
Positive thinking. So, hot sunny days.
All right.
Up and out west.
All right, moving on to executive session. Mr. Collier.
These are going to be separate.
You need a motion for the first one, Mayor.
You want to read it?
The executive session, A is to adjourn into executive session for the purpose of conferencing with the law director for the city to consider the employment of a public employee.
Second.
Motion by
Mr.
Lindsay,
second by Mr. Reynolds.
Mr. Reynolds. Discussion?
Council, any discussion before we move to a vote? Mr. Collier.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Mr. Leidy.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
No.
Mr. Lethley.
No.
Mr. Craybacher.
No.
Mayor Lowry.
No.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
The executive set motion to for the execs. Executive sessions fails 4-3. Number B, to adjourn into executive session for the purpose of conferencing with the law director for the city concerning pending litigation involving Kennedy Trust.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lowry.
Motion to go into executive session for the purpose of conferring with the law director pending the Kennedy Trust.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Rick Lowry and a second by Mr. Lethley.
Yes, sir.
Ms. Craybacher.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
No.
Mr. Lindsay.
No.
Mr. Leidy.
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. Lethley.
Yes.
Kennedy Trust executive session passes 4-3. 5-2.
Thank
five
you, sir.
Two.
All right. At this time, we will take a 5-minute break and move in.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
And move into executive session, which is a closed meeting to the public.
So, let me add for the record that when council is finished with their executive session and they return back into regular meeting, there'll be no other regular business conducted this evening. So there will be anything else discussed on the record. Thank you.
Take five and come back.